webinar series that is funded by grants from the Office of Health Strategy for Connecticut, and also our Health Information Exchange in Connecticut called CONI. And neither of these organizations has any undue influence on the content of this program. If we go to the next slide. My name's Tom Agresta. I'm an activity director for this continuing medical education and continuing pharmacy education series. And the series that we've done, and this is, I think, webinar number 6, is called Health Information Technology for Clinicians, How to Achieve Optimal Outcomes. So far, we've only been able to do webinars, but in the future, we hope to hold some in-person events as well. And I'm in the Department of Family Medicine and Center for Quantitative Medicine at UConn Health. If we go to the next slide, please. Our series has some topics that have ranged from medication safety and reconciliation to telehealth to health information exchange. And then we have some upcoming series that will be working on patient-generated health data and perhaps precision medicine as well. If you go to the next slide. A little bit of housekeeping. As the participants, your lines will be muted during the discussion. We will have the ability to do a question and answer session at the end. And what we're going to have you do is type in your questions into the chat or the question and answer, preferably the question and answer area, which you can find by going to the small little dots at the bottom of your screen and looking for Q&A. If we aren't able to address your questions immediately, we will try to pull together responses from our panelists and share them out after the session. The session is being recorded today, and it'll be available for download as well as for the slides. Will be available on a website in a few weeks, likely, and we will send out information about that, as well as how to get access for your continuing medical education and continuing professional education credit. Okay, so I'm going to just kind of close out our poll here and tell you who is, in fact, as part of our, is actually participating in this group here. So if you just give me a few seconds, then the poll will close out. And as we can see, we have a few physicians. We have many who had not answered, some pharmacists, about 14 pharmacists, a few PAs and APRNs, and a number of folks who kind of designate themselves as others. So that may be health IT, et cetera. And if you go to the next slide, I'm going to introduce our panelists. So our presenters and panelists today, first, we're going to start with Dr. David Henderson. He's the department chair for family medicine at UConn Health Center and also the associate dean for multicultural and community affairs. Next, we'll hear from Takesha Everett. She's the executive director of Health Equity Solutions. And Dr. Everett has been working as well at the state level on our Health Information Technology and Advisory Council and has done some work around health equity with regards to that. And last but not least, we have Dr. Jacob Ryder, who is a family physician and a fellow clinical informatician like myself, and is currently the CEO for the Alliance for Better Health. But Dr. Ryder has also spent some time working at the Office of National Coordinator for Health IT, where he was once the deputy director and interim director, and also working as the chief medical informatics officer for Allscripts in the past. And he is currently involved in a task force for the Health Information Management Society on the social determinants of health. So if we go to the next slide, we're going to have some learning objectives that are basically describing the benefits of collecting SDoH data on health outcomes, and how we can recognize as providers the underlying causes that impact individual and population health. We're going to talk about some of the challenges and some of the best practices for data collection and use. And we're not going to have complete solutions here, but we're going to have a path towards improving that. And then we're going to talk a little bit about some of the tools and solutions that are currently available. And perhaps Dr. Ryder will share some insight as to what is coming in the future as well. So if we go to the next slide. So I'm going to turn over now the presentation to Dr. Takesha Everett and have her walk us through the next series of slides.
Thank you so much, Tom, and thank you for having me here this afternoon. I am super excited to start off the conversation around social determinants of health, health equity, and health information technology. As previously mentioned, my name is Takesha Dewine Everett, and I am the Executive Director of Health Equity Solutions. And our focus is on advancing health equity through policy and systems change. I have realized over the course of doing this work that when you start the conversation around health equity or social determinants of health, it's really important to just start the conversation with some basic definitions. And while most of the definitions I'm going to offer over the next few minutes are definitions we all know, I'm hoping that I add a little bit of context and a little twist to why it's important to think of these things and the concepts related to health equity and the social determinants of health and how SDoH is not exactly health equity, but it's a key component of it. So first, this slide is talking about the definition of health, and we all kind of think about and know that health is more than just physical ailment. But what's really important to take a look at on this slide is the fact that in the United States, and even particularly in our state of Connecticut, we have an imbalance on how we focus our dollars as it relates to care around health versus where the actual issues and problems lie. What I mean is when you look at this image, you see that clinical care only relates to about 20% of the health outcomes, factors that affect health outcomes, whereas that's where we spend the bulk of our money is in the clinical care realm. Looking at this, over 50% of what is really a driver of health outcomes are the social and economic factors and the physical environment, broadly known as the social determinants of health, which I will define much more in depth in just a moment. When we're looking at health generally, looking beyond just physical health, but mental, physical, social well-being, the entirety of health, it's really important to understand that it's, yes, we do need to look at clinical care and what's happening there, but a lot of what is driving health is happening outside the four walls of a clinical setting. And we need to make sure that we're aligning those two things, that we are maximizing the opportunities that we have in clinical care to address those social and environmental factors, as well as making sure that when we contextualize those social and environmental factors, that in the clinical setting, that doctors, physicians, and healthcare providers have the information that's necessary and needed right at their fingertips to get people to optimal health. Next slide. So what do we mean when we say optimal health? And that's where I'm going to dive in deeper about defining health equity. Health equity is the fair and just opportunity for everyone to attain their optimal health without regard to social factors, or said differently, things such as race, ethnicity, income, geography, and other social factors. Social meaning they were created in the human realm and by humans, and thus we have the power to dismantle the control and the relationship that they have over one's health. It definitely involves that we learn and understand what communities need. This goes back to that point about what is happening in the social and environmental context that is driving poor health outcomes, inequitable health, and unequal delivery of healthcare and access to healthcare. What are those drivers and how do we understand what's happening at the community level? But understanding is only a part of it. We have to move into action. And today, what is really exciting to me is we're talking about how health information technology can help us move into action around such issues like the social determinants of health. It also means that we have to dismantle barriers and access to resources and ensure that people have exactly what they need. Now, one of the key things I want to go over on this slide, because it's really, really important, are these two images, many of which I'm sure you've seen some version of them before. And I'm going to go over this really quickly because it's not the it's not the core of our discussion today, but it is really, really important. For a very, very long time, we've been talking about a state of equality and making sure that everyone's treated equally. And when we look at the equal image, we see that we have three different persons with three different statuses. In this image, we're talking about health, we're talking about height status, but you could revert that and put it in as health status or any other status that is predetermined or not determined by one's own individual, by one own individual, but rather society or genetics or something else. And here we're trying to each person is trying to see the game and enjoy the game. And we give them the exact same resource, a box to look over the fence. Now, the problem in this image is that we're not effectively or efficiently using our resources because we're giving a resource to a person who in fact doesn't need it. The tallest person here does not need the box in order to see over the fence. We're actually treating each of them equally without necessarily paying attention to the fact that they're not all starting at the same place, even though they have the same end goal. When we look at the equity side of this, we're effectively and efficiently using our resources, and we're noting that we're giving people what they need based on where they started, because we all have the same goal to get to our endpoint of optimal health in this particular instance. So what does this mean for health information technology? If you're a clinician trying to get someone to a great state of health or a better state of health, without the contextual information of what's happening outside of the four walls of a clinical institution, or as you're engaging with this individual, you can't necessarily get them to their best point. Said differently, you don't know what resources are needed or necessary in order for them to effectively and efficiently get to their best health. Next slide. This gives another image, and I'm only going to spend here for a second, a different image of what we mean by health equity. On the last slide, we were talking about resources, the box. There were three boxes, and there's the question about whether who needs the box, who doesn't need the box. But in this image, what we see is everybody here needs a bike, but they need a bike that's tailored to their particular needs. And this again goes deeper into the point about health equity and marrying this with the social determinants of health. When we best understand the context within which people are living and what their needs are, we can better suit our treatment and our interventions to their specific need, and ensuring again the effective and efficient use of the resources we have. Next slide. And then you can skip to the next slide. You can go to the next one. Yep. So I've said social determinants of health a couple of times now, as has Tom, and I think it's important to just pause for a second before I go any further and say, what do I mean? The social determinants of health has become a very sexy term over the last better part of a decade, and that's for a specific reason. It's because we're beginning to very much understand that this inverse relationship between the dollars we spend in the clinical care setting versus what's happening outside of the clinical care setting is really something we need to reverse, and we need to impact this differently. We need to better understand the conditions in which people live, grow, are born, work, and age, so that we can understand better what their healthcare needs are and better design our interventions and get people to a better health status. The social determinants of health are really linked to the distribution of money, power, and resources, and this is impacted at the global, national, and local level. Next slide. This slide is from the Kaiser Family Foundation, and it shows their six domains of the social determinants of health. I believe this is one of the most comprehensive images that you can see around what the social determinants of health are. Now, some people call them social influencers, some people call them social drivers. It's all pretty much the same thing, what we're trying to say. Here you see that at the bottom, the health and well-being of each individual person or community, mortality rates, morbidity, life expectancy, the cost of healthcare, et cetera, is directly linked to the economic, neighborhood, and physical environment, education, food, community safety, and social context or healthcare system. All of these things are directly impacting one's health and well-being. When we look at this in the state of Connecticut, we definitely know a few key things that are worth highlighting. While we have some of the greatest wealth in our state, We also have one of the greatest wealth gaps in our state when we think about things along the continuum of race and ethnicity. We also know that the neighborhoods in Connecticut are not all equal as we go east to west or north to south, looking at urban centers versus the rural. We know that there are challenges between having safe, affordable housing, that there are challenges with having enough green space and the walkability and transportation all across the state are very difficult. And all of this has a relationship to health. We also know that while we have some of the greatest educational opportunities within the state, we do have ranking in the top 5 educational gaps in the United States. So here again, we have all of these issues that we know are directly tied to one's health outcomes, directly tied to health disparities, and directly tied to health equity. Food insecurity, we have a lot of major urban centers that don't have major grocery stores in every community, but rather rely on bodegas or mid-sized grocery stores to get healthy, fresh food, and that's very difficult. And we also know, particularly given all of the outcomes that are coming out related to the COVID-19 pandemic, that the community and social context, our social connectivity, is very strained. And lastly, while we have some of the greatest physicians, many of you who are listening today, and some of the greatest healthcare that our United States provides and can get, we also have some of the greatest gaps in access. When I say this differently, in a lot of reports, we rank in the top 5 healthiest states in the nation. But within those same reports, we rank near the bottom when it comes to health disparities. So we definitely have some work to do in terms of getting people to their best health in our state when we look at all of the domains around the social determinants of health. And key here is understanding, how do we marry what's happening in communities with what's happening in the clinical setting? Now, I'm gonna go over one more slide, but I'm gonna come back to that point about how do we marry what's happening in communities with what's happening in the clinical care setting to get us to a better health state. So let me go to the next slide and then I'll get back to that point. So why is any of this important? Here's why. The factors that make up our individual and community health impact all of us. So while we can herald that we're in the top 5 healthiest states in the nation, we at the same time must be concerned and quite frankly embarrassed that we rank at the lowest when it comes to health disparities and health inequities. So this is really critical. And while it impacts everyone, we're not all impacted the same way. And thus we need to make sure that we're making a clear connection between the differences that exist, that we're not all starting at the same place, and making sure that we all have what we need. And then lastly, it's important to understand that these social determinants are not happening by accident. They're definitely linked to the historical relationship between difference and discrimination and different challenges that we have had around race, ethnicity, and gender, as well as geography throughout the history of our state and our nation. But what do we do about it? Next slide. We can know all of these things have a relationship, but what exactly do we do about it? And where does health information technology come in, particularly in the conversation of health equity? Well, from my perspective, I'm really excited because, for one, it seems like, well, actually, it's not even, it seems like, it's the fact that we have technology everywhere, but at the same time, we don't have technology anywhere that is really working together seamlessly to pull in the information about what's happening in the social and community context, that social and physical environmental space, into the clinical care setting. So I, for one, am a big proponent of health information exchanges and different technology that we can use that help clinicians and providers better understand what's happening in the community setting. One of the key things when I think about social determinants of health and health information technology is it helps this complicated image that you're looking at right now, where there's technology and information everywhere. It helps streamline it into such a way that it's usable and impactful at the point of clinical interactions. It is also helpful, not only just at the point of clinical interactions, but in the help of social service interactions. When we all have the opportunity to work together and better understand What is the healthcare diagnosis or the healthcare needs that a person has, paired with what's happening in the social and environmental context, then we can use that data in an effective way to make sure that people are getting to the health status that they need, to the health status that they can, and that they get the optimal healthcare that they deserve. I always tell people that this is an issue that is both personal and professional for me. I'm someone who's experienced a lot of health inequity along the way, simply because, as I think back on it, many of my physicians and healthcare providers didn't have the information at their fingertips to better understand the social context, the environmental context of what was happening in terms of my health. They only knew, and particularly, and I think as a young age, they only knew that I was a person presenting with asthma and had difficulties related to that, but didn't understand all of the things that were happening in my home, in my community, and in my environment that was exacerbating the issue. When we think about health information technology and the opportunity that's in front of us, we can better arm our clinical care providers with the information necessary to move people to better health. And there are a lot of ways we can do this. One example that I'll think of really quickly, and then I'll turn it over to the next speaker, involves the story that I've heard about how data in Maryland has been used in a health information exchange to really reduce the number of falls that are happening among senior citizens. How did they do that? Looking at zip code data and understanding what the housing stock in that community looked like, and making sure that when a patient came in from different particular zip codes in different areas, asking them key questions about how their housing was set up. Do you live on the first or the second floor of your home? Do you have these following supports supports in your home in order to prevent falls, et cetera, et cetera? And then linking them to the key changes necessary to make their homes more safe and to reduce the fall risk. Now, that's not exactly a health equity example, but it gives us an opportunity to see how in real time, an example of such data that is related specifically to housing and the housing stock that someone the housing opportunity that someone lives in can definitely be linked to their healthcare outcomes. I'm really excited to see the future where we have more streamlined health information because we have effective technology that helps us understand what the social determinants of health for any one person, any one community, and our population are experiencing so that we can best tie those two things together to get them to their best health. And with that, I now turn it over. Oh, wait, I do have one last slide, and then I'll turn it over to Dr. Henderson. So one piece that I never like to leave any conversation with is making you think that equity is the endpoint. Actually, liberation is the endpoint. And in the context, I could go way deeper into this, but I want to keep it into the context of health information technology. What we need in the health information technology space is true liberation, where both patients and providers have access to real-time data that is meaningful and useful to each of them at the point that they need it. When we're talking about liberating data, when we're talking about data justice, when we're talking about information technology justice generally and specifically, it's making sure that just not one aspect or one sector of our community has access to health information technology, but rather that all of us do, and that we have that we have access to the data that we need when we need it. So with that, I turn it over to Dr. Henderson, and I look forward to the questions and answers at the end.
Thank you so much, Dr. Everett, for kind of starting us on our journey. And now we're going to have Dr. Henderson talk a little bit more about what's happening in the healthcare delivery system now and what's happening in the educational system now that's starting to make a difference, but it's only partway along the path. So go ahead, Dave.
Dr. Cresta, thank you very much. And Dr. Everett, thank you. I'd like to start by sort of piggybacking on what Dr. Everett talked about with regard to contextualizing social determinants in clinical settings. Next slide. To that end, we'll go on, start with a little bit of a history lesson. I came to UConn as a full-time faculty member, I believe in 2003, in one of the sort of early talks that I gave to students, I referenced an article, which I could not find to save my life for this presentation, but basically the article demonstrated that 26% of patient outcomes were related to family connections. And this, I think, for me was my sort of general introduction to the impact of social determinants. But we see social determinants in many different settings. Again, sort of context is important. We look at patient outcomes often through the lens of race. Good examples are fetal and maternal outcomes and the increased incidence of chronic kidney disease in African Americans related to hypertension. We also look at outcomes based and disparities in transplantation based on race. Vaccine hesitancy has been a huge part of the conversation recently in communities of color, and that's been sort of carried out in the context of race and ethnicity. Incidence of alcoholism and other sort of alcohol related disease in Native American communities, again, has been looked at on the basis of ethnicity. I remember when I was in medical school, one of the theories at the time was that Native Americans had an increased risk of alcoholism related to decreased alcohol dehydrogenase levels. Next slide, please. But again, context is important. The lens with which we look at things is really important, because what the sort of article that I referenced before actually demonstrated, it wasn't specifically family connections, because family was defined as anybody who lived under your roof, regardless of whether they had a biological relationship to you. What was really important about those relationships is that they shared, is that you all share a common environment with people that that you live with, and that social environment is really the key. Issues related to maternal and fetal mortality aren't really due to race, because we know that race is not a biological construct. The underlying issue is actually racism. I mean, that's the social issue that that is driving those outcomes. And also, when we look at inequities in transplantation, we have structural issues within the system, and also sort of personally mediated issues to the extent that African Americans tend to be referred for transplantation at lower rates than whites by their providers. The issue of access to vaccinations and has been, I think, suppressed by the conversation that we've been having around vaccine hesitancy. And if we think about it, this is also a good example of a structural issue, because the vaccine infrastructure was built on top of the testing infrastructure. And we know that there were issues related to access that resulted in disparities in testing. And again, those same structural issues are a big part of the reason for the underlying inequities in vaccination rates too. But our conversation around hesitancy basically sort of blurs the importance of access. And again, with regard to Native Americans, there was actually a very good study out in 2016 that actually revealed that Native Americans don't have an increased incidence of alcohol use disorders at all compared to the general white population. And that the reasons that Native Americans may have alcohol use disorders are the same reasons that others in our population have alcohol use disorders. And so again, sort of similar social issues that lead to mental health issues that drive alcohol use disorders. Next slide, please. So back in the dark ages, when I went to medical school, I've been around a few years, The social history that I was taught consisted of essentially three items, sex, drugs, and we left out the rock and roll because we really aren't a terribly exciting population, and substituted work. Who you lived with, if you had a sexual partner or sexual partners, what your marital status was, tobacco, alcohol, and other substance use, and one's employment. And that was really the information that we collected. Next slide, please. I think now we've become significantly more sophisticated, particularly given the advent of EHRs. And so now we actually collect a lot more information. This is just a screenshot from our occurrence of Epic in the at a residency site. And so we can see that the social determinants of health that are built into our system relate to financial insecurity, housing insecurity, food insecurity, transportation issues, and issues related to social connections. Next slide, please. And again, this is just another view with a couple of these sections expanded, and we can see some of the questions that are embedded in the system, and also sort of how all of this is documented in the system. And so you can see we have come a long way from the very sort of narrow social history that I was taught when I was a medical student. Next slide, please. And this is a redacted view of a report that our IT specialist here pulled for one of our residents who's doing QI project on food insecurity. We were able to pull up all the responses to food insecurity from all the patients who are on the team that this resident is associated with. And this was part of a QI project that he was doing. Again, so we're able to collect data and actually manipulate it as well. Next slide, please. These sort of changes, have implications on how we do the work that we do, and how well we can do the work that we do. There are implications on workflow as well as data use. The workflow implications, depending on where you are, can be relatively simple, because social determinants, to the extent that they are influential in patients' development and experience of disease, and in defining patients' health, can be treated in the same way that we conventionally treat medications. The MA in the office can review the patient's social determinants with them prior to rooming them, document that, the provider follows the MA. The provider can review that with the patient. More specifics can be documented, and the capacity to collect this information allows for the collaboration in a setting, particularly where there are a number of healthcare professionals working together in a team-based manner actually more fully meet the needs of patients than in traditional models of practice. You get facilitation of communication and referrals to other sources of care. These problems can be followed forward in history. They can help facilitate community-based care as well as help us share aggregated data outside the office with our community partners and with agencies such as local and state departments of health. Next slide, please. So a focus on social determinants is also shaping how we provide education to students and students' experience. Community health leaders is a program that actually one of our third year medical students started. He went out and gathered an army of undergrads who were interested in careers in healthcare, and developed a plan to locate them in primary care offices, just sort of have them in a relatively secure place in the waiting room to interview patients as they were waiting to be called in for their visits, to gather information and document it related to social determinants of health. This information was then transferred to the providers, who documented it in the system as a way of, again, another way of getting social determinants of health and information relevant to them into the patient's record, so that action could be taken. Interestingly enough, this all occurred right at the beginning of the COVID pandemic, and everything was all set and we're about to start, and then COVID hit. And of course, having a bunch of undergrads running around primary care offices was not such a good idea during COVID. And so the project was almost shelved, but at least in our residency site, we were actually able to transfer the activity of this project onto a phone-based telehealth platform. And so we continued to have students interacting with our patients to collect social determinants of health information for us. And we're in the process of, again, with the help of students, developing a QI project to take a look at how effective this was. Next slide, please. UConn is part of a group of schools that were pulled together by the AMA into a consortium, which is the ACE or Change Med Ed Consortium, depending on what time in history you sort of come across a consortium, because it changed names a couple times. But its purpose is to drive change in medical education. And there is a small working group that I've been part of that sort of developed and piloted and tested a revamped version of the history and physical. I mean, those of you who are sort of familiar with the way medical students are taught to gather information, as I demonstrated before, the social history is just a tiny little snippet of the information that is gathered, and it's usually sort of buried with a lot of other information. This revamped version of the H&P, the sort of 360-degree H&P, actually expands the amount of social information that's collected and actually moves it up in the interaction with the patient. So as students introduce themselves and get the patient's chief complaint, the next step is actually to start to engage them in a conversation around social determinants. And there are three basic domains: the patient's perception of health, the patient's priorities and goals, then an expanded version of the social history that I learned when I was in medical school. And so the domain of the patient's perception of health encompasses just basically the patient's understanding and insight into their health overall, and any particular illnesses that they may have, their overall perception of what it means to them to be healthy, their self-assessed level of control of the factors that they recognize as impacting their health, and their sort of self-identified strengths and barriers. The domain of patient priorities and goals looks more specifically at sort of the psychosocial realm, and queries patients about issues related to mood and thought patterns, and any previously diagnosed or perhaps undiagnosed psychiatric issues, as well as some pertinent social issues. And the social history is expanded into four subdomains: behavioral, relationships, resources, and functional status. Behavioral, again, relates to patient behaviors. I think Dr. Everett went over a slide that demonstrated the impact of patient behaviors on health as, again, a significant contributing factor to patient outcomes. But it's basic health behaviors, such as medication adherence, nutritional behaviors, their level of physical activity, and substance abuse. Relationships explore patients' relationships with their sort of nuclear family and their sort of their closest associates, and sort of their primary relationships, as well as the level of social support they may have, any issues related to violence or abuse that may be going on in the home, as well as relationships within the community and membership in various community organizations that are important to them. Resources are, that domain is relevant to food, housing, insecurity, financial insecurity, as well as transportation and functional status. Basically covers both social and occupational functioning and their capacity to conduct ADLs and their overall satisfaction with the state and tenor of their lives. I mean, so this is a much more sort of robust exploration of social factors with patients than I was ever taught to conduct when I was in high school, residency, or any time since then. Next slide, please. So the capacity to collect this information, to document it, presents a lot of opportunities, but also some challenges. I mean, we need better IT infrastructure to collect, gather, and aggregate this information. We need better education of our students, or certainly different education of our students at both the undergraduate and graduate medical education level. We need much better data integration. We need to, and Dr. Everett talked about this as well, we need to be able to use some, to add information gathered at the clinical practice level to other public health data sets, as well as other data gathered in the community, such as hotspotting, as an example, to get a fuller picture of how of the relationship between social determinants and health outcomes in individual patients at a community level and at a broader population level. Next slide, please. One relatively new and fairly sort of easy advantage that we have has occurred in coding. Many of you are probably familiar with Z codes in their use in health maintenance visits, but there are also social determinants of health Z codes. As an example, if we look at education literacy, there are 7 Z codes for education literacy. For issues related to employment or lack thereof, there are 12 Z codes. For issues related to problems in patients' upbringing, there are 24 Z codes. I mean, so there are a lot of Z codes, and this is just an example of a few that we can actually use in our documentation of diagnoses. And the advantage that gives us, next slide, please, is that we can document social determinants of health in a way that's really easily searchable. If we don't have an IT person who can run sometimes sort of complicated reports for us, sort of diagnosis codes are generally fairly easily searchable in most EMRs. And so we can use social determinants of health along with diagnosis codes. They can also help express the level of complexity or risk associated with that particular diagnosis. I mean, so they add some context there, which can sometimes be important from a billing perspective, but that's not specifically what we're talking about here today, but just from purely a documentation perspective, because that then in turn facilitates referrals and follow-up, of patients, and we can actually to sort of track practice trends. We can do reports and quality improvement projects to evaluate how we are providing care to patients. So as an example, if I find if I'm sort of able to use social determinants in a way that I find that 25% of my patient population with a specific diagnosis sort of also have issues related to a particular a social determinant, then maybe I should be screening larger portions of my population for social determinant and or providing some patient education related to that particular problem. But as a just sort of quick example, this is an example that I pulled off the AAP website. You got a new patient who comes in with a child who's complaining of poor weight gain and poor intake. You uncover that there are a number of social issues that are contributing to the problem the child is having. And in your note, you document that the child is underweight. You make the diagnosis of failure to thrive, and document that the child has a very low BMI, but you also document lack of adequate food and safe drinking water. Again, as a social determinant related to the diagnoses above. And this allows us to, again, contextualize all of the other three diagnoses in light of a particular social determinant, which itself becomes a point for action in developing a plan for this patient. So I think that social determinants can add a lot to how we care for patients. It can help us more specifically personalize the care that we provide for patients. But we are sort of just at the beginning of the sort of IT structures that we need to really make integrating social determinants into the delivery of care truly robust. But thank you, and I will end here. And I think I need to turn it back over to Dr. Gresta because I think there's a quiz. Dr. Gresta.
Yeah, we won't call it a quiz. We'll call
okay.
it a...
I'm sorry.
And I
spent too much time in school. Never mind.
And we'll call it a poll, and you'll see that the poll is open. And I know some folks have started to actually respond. If you go to the next slide. It's really sort of asking what you perceive is the greatest benefit of collecting SDoH. And that's for, so if you imagine, I know some of you are not healthcare providers, but just imagine you were a healthcare provider or working in some kind of place where you need this information, what would be the most important reason to kind of collect it? And you'll have about another minute or two to kind of answer that question. And while you think about that, we're going to go ahead and queue up the slides for Dr. Ryder, and after we finish up with his slides, we'll show you what the answer to that is as we do our another poll. So go ahead, Dr. Ryder, you're on.
Thank you, Dr. Gresta. So I'm going to talk about the nexus of social determinants of health and information technology. And as Tom expressed at the beginning of our time together, my career has been primarily at the nexus of medicine and information technology. So it's only in the last, say, 5 years that I have learned to spell SDoH. So it's been a fascinating adventure for me. I'll talk a little bit about the company that I now work for to start, which is called Alliance for Better Health. Alliance for Better Health is 100% focused on social determinants of health, and we'll get into a little bit of more detail about what we do. But as you've heard from the previous two speakers, and it's great to go last because now you're all experts on what SDoH are. and you're not yet experts on some of the frontline work that an organization like ours does. So what we do is we work primarily with community-based organizations, although we call them social care providers, because sometimes a social care provider could be a hospital. But in our definition of social care provider, it's that you provide social care services that are not reimbursed by traditional either insurance companies or government reimbursement. So if you're doing something like, you know, providing physical exams or taking care of kids' ear infections or whatever, those are billable services. But if you're if you're a hospital and you're giving somebody a free ride home, or if you're picking them up and bringing them to the supermarket, those are not billable services, and therefore you qualify as a social care provider. If you're a food pantry or a homeless shelter, or provide job education or even benefits navigation, those are also not reimbursable services. So they're obviously social care services under our rubric. But we've been careful not to just say community-based organizations. So what we do is we help community organizations in their implementation of social care services. We make sure that individuals who have social needs, not unlike the vignette that Dr. Henderson just referenced. So if this child's family doesn't have sufficient food, if they have food insecurity, how do we identify that? And then how do we get them to folks who will help them with food insecurity? And then last, and I'll go into some detail about this, we figure out if that intervention actually results in better health for the people that we serve. And that's an important last step. And we'll get into some of the reasons for why that is. And for whoever's putting on the slide, I'm just gonna change my appearance every time I want a new slide. So now I got my Red Sox hat on. So let's talk first about information technology. Information technology is really anything that is used. It's not necessarily a computer. It could be a phone. It could be a transceiver of some kind. It could be, you know, one of these new Apple tags that you apparently tells you if your dog has gone around the corner. Next slide. There are 38 of these. And so you think that people who are interested in information technology are just the nerds. Next slide. But it's not just the nerds, it's the people who give a crap about the people we serve. And that's what's important. And so I talked earlier about making sure that the things that we are doing really work. And I'm going to go into greater detail downstream, but the important thing is we can't do that without measuring the work that gets done, right? So if I give a family food, then I have to be able to figure out, well, what happened downstream with the family? And I think there are important implications for the medical community as it interacts with the social care community, because if the two aren't working together, the medical community can never understand if the people that are served are better, and they won't understand who got served and who didn't get served. So next slide. Create all kinds of, and so what is it? What's the stuff that's flowing through the pipes of information technology? Well, obviously it's information. Next slide. We'll just try and go speed demon. So this is, you know, obviously a depiction of technology. The technology that we use in our instance of social determinants interventions, generally involve a series of steps, and both speakers, previous speakers mentioned some of this. We capture information, we pull it all together, we figure out what it means, and then we do something as a product of what happened there. So next slide. So we're going to walk through this step by step. So the first step here is the acquisition of information. Now, how we acquire that information is variable. You heard Dr. Henderson talk about how we teach medical students how to capture information. This is, of course, variable. And if we have humans doing it, we will have a great deal of variability. We might ask biased questions. We might find ourselves you know, filling out surveys, which would work great for some people and won't work great for other people, right? If I'm filling out a survey and I can't read, it's going to be really hard for me to do that. So the step one is we have to meet individuals where they are, and then we have to use culturally sensitive, language sensitive tools to capture as much information as we possibly can so that we can understand what the needs are that individuals may need. After we capture information, we have to pull it together in some way, because we can't make sense of it, right? We can't say 14% of the population has food insecurity if we don't understand what percentage of the population really has food insecurity. So we pull it all together, and by pulling it all together, we can then analyze it and make some sense of it. And then once we make sense of it, we say, well, now what? What do we do? What do we do as a product of this analysis that we have just performed? And what's important as we process that product is that we're actually generating additional data. So we're turning the wheel again, because remember that data can be captured in many ways, and it may or may not be represented in terms of a survey or something like that. So just by providing a service, if we capture information about the provision of that service, then we've captured more information, and then we turn the wheel again. So next slide. So we're going to walk through this very briefly. So technology forms the foundation of all of this. If we do things really well, all we're doing is sort of sniffing at the exhaust of the engine that runs this thing in a circle. So next slide. And this is just my depiction of information flowing all around this circle at every turn of the wheel. We'll get into some detail about what the products are that we might use. You've heard references to electronic health records, and those are certainly tools that clinicians use. But what are the tools that non-clinicians use? And I remember Dr. Agresta spoke briefly above about some of our attendees. So we have some physicians, we have some IT folks, and we have some pharmacists here, I think. So next slide. So we'll try and address all parts. So these are the three domains of how I think about healthcare. And so you may have, you know, if you talk to your mother-in-law or someone who doesn't know you all that well at a cocktail party, and they say, so what kind of work do you do? And you might say, well, I work in healthcare, right? And so that applies to a pharmacist, applies to one of you IT nerds, it applies to physicians, social workers, et cetera. But when my mom hears healthcare, she thinks of the depiction on the lower right, right? Medical care. And let's get another prop. There we go. See, healthcare. We got our stethoscope on and we're all set. But that's not necessarily the case, because healthcare also involves behavioral health. And if we think of healthcare as the sum of medical care, behavioral health, and social care, then we can go back to Takesha's slide, where she made it very clear that the minority, 20% of what those folks in the lower right-hand corner, despite what Dr. Agresta and Dr. Henderson would want, you know, would tell their medical students that, you know, implicitly, of course, because both of them are culturally sensitive. But the implicit message of the medical community is you are the hub of the wheel. You are the center of attention. But that is not at all the case. The person is the center, and 80% of what happens in that person's life has nothing to do with us, nothing to do with the medical system. So for that 80% of their lives, how do we engage, and how do we make sure we understand what are the social needs, what are the behavioral health needs, and let's intervene there so that their problems, the problems people encounter there, don't cascade into the medical domain? Because what we want to do is we want to keep people away from the doctors. Yes, we do. Keep people away from the doctors. Next slide. So how do we do that? Well, we acquire information, we aggregate information, we analyze information, we act on that information. Because if we act on that information and prevent the cascade down the hill from, you know, lots of worry about where am I going to get my next meal, and or I don't have a place to sleep tonight. Well, those are problems that are definitely going to cause behavioral health challenges. And those behavioral health challenges are definitely going to cause medical challenges. So the purpose of this virtuous cycle is to prevent people from falling down that cascade. We'll go to the next slide. And the next and the next. So social needs, next slide. We'll just try and fast forward here, right? We need to identify them. We need to understand them. And then we need to act on them. So the first question is, how do we identify them? Next slide. Okay, we'll keep going. Next slide. There we go. So when we identify a social need, and we'll go into some of the screening tools that we use, what we need to do is we need to communicate the identification of that problem. And so let's say we'll take Dr. Henderson's example, and we'll turn it into a 17-year-old from a child with failure to thrive, and we'll say, well, this 17-year-old, we've identified some social problems that the family has that are interfering with this 17-year-old's health. So what we need to do is we need to communicate that concern, ideally, you know, with the permission and engagement of the individual, to say an organization. So let's say this is a 17-year-old who's depressed, and is therefore, and we know this, at risk for suicide. So how do we intervene, and how do we understand what to do about this situation? Well, where do we go to for help to engage a 17-year-old who needs help with a social issue? Well, in the case of somebody who has depression, we might want to find a social worker or a psychologist or somebody in the behavioral health domain who can help us address these issues. And so we have to communicate that this individual has a need. We need to refer this individual to the service provider who can provide a service. And then we need to confirm so that that person isn't just left, you know, in limbo, not having either received the referral, or maybe they don't have space, maybe they're closed, maybe they're too busy. So we need to confirm, because if we don't close that loop, we're going to leave this person in limbo. Next slide. Click. So in the olden days, raise your hand if you've seen one of these in the past, the younger, oh, can we go back to the previous one just for a millisecond? Uh-oh, we've gone way back. The yellow sticky, there we go. So this is how we did things in the olden days. So let's say I was in the office as a family doctor. I'll put my stethoscope back on, and I would say, oh, you know, I understand that this family has a problem with food insecurity. Let me Google that, and I will find the phone number of the food pantry. And, you know, I promise I did this, and I'm a little embarrassed to say that I did it back in the dark ages of the early 1990s. And I would write the number of the food pantry down, and I would hand it to somebody, and I would say, there you go. And that was my social referral intervention. There was no, now we go to the next slide. There we go. No loop closure. We never found out if anybody made it to where we intended for them to go. We didn't find out if they were close enough, if they were closed, if they met their needs, if they didn't meet their needs. And so there were all kinds of open loops, right? We made referrals, and we never had any follow-up. We were always guessing about whether the referrals that we made had positive impact, and we couldn't, of course, measure that people who got services were more healthy or potentially less healthy than people who didn't get referrals, because we had no data. So now, next slide, we have technology. And so I'm going to talk a little bit now about the technology that we use in our organization, but also writ large sort of technology assessment of how the nation is looking to fit these pieces together. So we'll go to the next slide. So the step one, or step zero, as I have in my image here. So we're going to go from step zero to, I think, step four through these slides. Step zero is we have to screen. And screening, as some of you learned in your clinical training, is we look for a problem when we don't know there to be one, right? That is the definition of screening. And so when you get your colonoscopy, it's not because anybody's worried you have colon cancer. It's that there's a chance that you do, and turns out that looking for it is really important. So we have to ask questions, and this is what I talked about earlier. And this can be done interactively, but the researchers all tell us that if we do it in a consistent way, that we will get better data and we will be able to act on that data more readily. And so what we use in our community is a validated screening tool, and every medical provider and every social care provider administers this screening tool to every individual with whom they have an encounter. And so if you go to the food pantry workers now screen for other social problems. If you go to the doctor and or somebody in the doctor's office will screen for social problems. And so in the past, the doctor looked for medical problems, the food pantry looked for food problems, and everybody saw things through their own very narrow lens. Now we broaden the lens, and using some of the codes that Dr. Henderson talked about, we can express the person's need in a very discrete way. And so if somebody has a given problem, we know it, it's recorded in a computer system that everybody in the community has access to, and then that provider of whatever service it is, whether it's a behavioral health provider or a food pantry or a doctor, then take some action. Next slide. So what do we do after screening? Well, we got to figure out where to go. So this is a phone book. Again, for those of you who are younger, this is how we used to figure out how to call somebody else. So I would look up people in the phone book, and then I would find their phone number. And then I would use this thing that you would put your finger in and move this dial thingy. And then the person at the other end would say hello. No text messaging and none of that was possible back in the day. We now have a digital version of that. And so let's say I identify a need of food insecurity. I would look in the directory for a provider of an organization that addresses food insecurity. I might ask the individual where they live, and I might want to use a map functionality to find the provider that's closest to them. And then I would send a referral that I find in the directory to the organization that I found in the directory. So now we'll go to the next slide. So this was step one of, so I send a message. So I'd send the referral, I send the message, and then the organization, next slide, this is the easy part, makes contact. Now, the way we do it in our community is we have two models, because what if I don't know who provides a service and I can't find them in the directory? So let me try and think of something. Maybe somebody needs a ride to the supermarket, but they live in a rural area. So there's no Uber or Lyft in a rural area, because in our region, which is the Capital District of New York, we can use Uber and Lyft, and we will frequently provide ride services to people who need rides, and that because transportation, of course, is a social need. So we'll give you a free ride to the supermarket. But if you're rural, we don't have Uber and Lyft. So what we have is a little team of what we call resource navigators, and our team catches the balls that no one knows who to throw them to. So either you throw the ball to somebody who you know to throw the ball to, and that might be the organization that I talked about earlier, or you send it to the navigator team and you say, hey, I have a person, we have identified a need, but I don't know who provides services that address these needs. But in any case, in either scenario, you're using information technology to send a message, and that message then gets transmitted to a receiving organization, either from one of our navigators or to the endpoint. Next slide. So now we're going to get technical a little bit. Next slide. So Dr. Henderson talked about standards. I'm just going to make reference to the interoperability standards advisory. which is put out by the organization that Tom referenced that is a part of Health and Human Services, the United States government. I was the deputy national coordinator of this organization. And what this organization does is it creates, it maintains a set of standards that are recommended for technology vendors to use in their systems so that when one system sends a message, another system can receive that message and it's using the same language. This is the, you know, there are standards for how your cell phones talk to each other and how email moves back and forth. And so now there need to be standards, next slide, that are vocabulary standards. And so Dr. Henderson mentioned some of them, the Z codes, which are a subset of CPT codes. So these are just examples, I'm not going to read them, of different kinds of codes. And so the core message here is that we also need codes that represent the social needs and the interventions for the social needs so that we can connect things together in a standard way. Next slide. So the Gravity Project is something, if anybody wants to Google it in your spare time or in another window, I won't get you in trouble for doing that. Now, the Gravity Project is one of a handful of initiatives, but it's the core initiative that's happening nationally that aligns with the work at the Office of the National Coordinator to create the right vocabulary standards that, and Dr. Henderson gave you an example of earlier, so that we can code carefully. A challenge with this program is that doctors know what Z codes are. Food pantry workers do not, and it is my belief that we should not medicalize the language that we're using. So I don't want to impose Z codes on food pantry workers. I want to capture information in a language that food pantry workers understand and that psychologists understand in psychology and that transportation workers understand in transportation. So we don't want to medicalize the social determinants of health domain because remember, 80% of the work that's done that you know aligns with people's health has nothing to do with doctors. So let's not, you know, be too paternalistic in how we think about the standards of how we implement here. Next slide. Getting close to the end, kids. So the products, you can hear a pattern here, right? We screen, we look up in a directory, we refer, and then that last part is we have to close the loop. And so when an individual shows up or doesn't show up, that's recorded and it's recorded in a system so that everybody knows. And that's very important that everybody knows. Now, I'm not saying that we have to send a message back to the referring organization to say, hey, they made it to the food pantry. But it's in the system. So if someone were to look up and see, you know, how many people actually made it to the place we sent them. So I'll tell you, in the beginning of our organization in 2016, our success rate was around about 35%. So you can do the math. 65% of the people we've referred places never made it. And, you know, this is when you start to measure things, you understand how rotten you are at doing the work that you do. We're up to about 70% now, which we think is great, but obviously that means that 25% of people aren't making it. Now it's possible that that's good news, right? Maybe somebody doesn't have a need anymore and they ended up not needing that need and then they didn't show up. So we also need to find ways of figuring out, you know, who were the positive deviants, not just the negative deviants. Next slide. And so these are examples. I am careful not to endorse one company or product or another, but I'll talk a little bit about each of these as examples. There are others in addition to these four, but four fit on the slide pretty nicely. So Unite Us is a platform, and it happens to be the platform that our organization uses. But you know, we are also engaged and have worked collaboratively with people from all of the other organizations that are listed here and several others. So the core of what these products do is the stuff that we talked about earlier. They do things in slightly different ways. You know, Aunt Bertha, for example, really started as a directory, and they have evolved their functionality so that they now do manage closed loop referrals. NowPow also started with lots of directory work and a little bit of referrals, and then they added the closed loop. UniteUS started with the closed loop and then has added directory capability, but you'll see UniteUS communities are have usually smaller directories because every organization that's in a UniteUS directory is an organization that's part of the network that has committed to a certain level of service of how fast they'll respond to a referral and so forth. And Healthify has generally marketed to different kinds of organizations, more on the health plan side. All of these companies have marketed to health plans and health systems. And this actually brings up an interesting problem. In some communities, there's more than one of these. And one of the challenges that we have today is that these systems don't generally talk to each other because they're not built to send messages to each other. So some of the work that's going on literally as we speak, I've had two calls about it today and I have several more this week nationally, is work that is being done both by HIMSS that Tom mentioned earlier and by the folks at the Office of the National Coordinator to figure out, well, what are the standards and how can we make sure that if you are using UniteUS and the food pantry is using NowPal, that your referral can get from UniteUS to NowPal? Or what if you're using Epic, an EHR? Can that referral, can you look something up and then can you send a referral into UniteUS that then perhaps, you know, the food pantry wasn't the right place to go and the food pantry bounces the referral to another facility, right? And so if it's all interoperable, just like email or text messages, then it just works. We'll go to the next slide. And we're getting close to being at time. And so I want to mention Conni, which Dr. Agresta mentioned earlier. So I Googled Conni because I wasn't familiar with her. Next slide. And this is what I found. Lots of people named Conni. And then I had to hone my Google search. Next slide. Because this is what we're talking about. So the Health Information Exchange. And you know, of course, I'm mocking myself. I was a founding member of HIXNI, the Health Information Exchange of New York, about 20 years ago. And Conni is the Connecticut version. And the great thing about Conni is that it's not 20 years old. And so it's been built on technology and it has aspirations that are more aligned with the needs of 2021, which is really exciting. Next slide. So I think Conni represents an opportunity. And one opportunity, for example, with Conni would be that it could serve as a global, perhaps global statewide, obviously, directory, right? So the easy answer of what could Conni do is Connecticut could pull together and create a directory and it could be hosted in or connected to Conni. And that way there's one place to go look for, you know, who provides which service rather than, you know, try and build them within each instance of a community, right? You don't really want Hartford having one and New Haven having another and, you know, Glastonbury having a third, you know, because it's silly to have all three of those. Next slide. Because ultimately what you want to do is this, right? Remember what we were trying to achieve, right? Acquire information, aggregate information, pull it together. Where do we pull it together? Conni, of course. And then we can act on it. Next slide. Because the point here is not to have a solution looking for a problem, right? You don't want to create Conni and say, well, what can we do with this? You want to figure out what the problem is. And I think as we've heard from the previous two speakers and perhaps also from me, there are real problems here to solve. And from my perspective, connecting individuals with needs to the services that address those needs is problem number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And so how do we make sure that happens? Before information technology, we couldn't do it. With an information technology framework like this, we can, and I think Conni represents an opportunity to address many of those needs. Next slide. Because we want to make the right thing to do, next slide, the easy thing to do. So the easier it is, the more likely it's going to be to happen. If you have to, you know, click on 19 buttons and do a bunch of other things, you know, nobody's going to do it. And especially if you are a food pantry worker and you have a high school education and you're trying to use three different computer systems, we're toast. So that person needs to be trained on one system and use one system. Next slide. Almost at the finish line here. So we started with a question, do social interventions work? Last slide. Well, we're going to have to look at the data. In our community, the answer is yes. And I'll give you one example. I mentioned that we've been giving free rides to people. When we give people free rides to Narcotics Anonymous and Alcoholics Anonymous meetings, those people end up in the emergency department significantly less frequently than they had in the previous 12 months. So we looked at 2 years, pre-intervention, post-intervention, and the data told us that a social intervention worked. It has return on investment. It was cheaper for us to spend $7 on a ride across town than it was to spend $700 or even $7,000 on an ED visit. And this is good for the person because they didn't suffer, and it was good for the health plan and or the state Medicaid program because they didn't have to pay for that emergency room visit. So that is all for me, and I'm going to hand the baton back to Dr. Agresta to entertain us more.
Thank you, Jacob, and thank you for kind of closing the loop on our conversation. So as you know, you can kind of see the poll results before show that we did want to do things like provide higher quality of care and more personalized care. And if you go to the next slide, we're going to open up another poll, and we'll let that run while we kind of start our possibility for answering questions. So we can put questions into the Q&A and into the chat, and we can then go ahead and start answering questions and kind of giving them to the individual or the group to help answer them. And so I guess I'll start with asking a question, and I'm going to kind of go back and ask Keisha, after hearing some of what Dr. Ryder had kind of discussed, what would you want from some of the things that he's doing to happen in our state in Connecticut? And Keisha, if you're speaking, you're on.
Oops, sorry. How's that?
That's much better.
I was going to say, I can be really quick and say all the things. I think that we have so much that we can learn from what Dr. Ryder shared. And I honestly don't know that it's worth me going into any further detail than saying, I think we're on a good path, but I think a lot of what he shared could even enhance what we're doing so far.
Excellent. Dave, what are your thoughts?
I mean, I'm inclined to agree with what Dr. Everett said. I mean, I think sort of helping practitioners and individual practices and practice groups develop, I mean, sort of common architecture with regard to the way they at least aggregate information. I mean, we sort of collect it how we collect it, but I think trying to develop some common architecture with regard to how we collect it would make it easier to sort of aggregate into larger data sets across practices and share with folks at a community level. And so I think that is actually a really important important step forward. And I think helping practitioners and practices understand the power that exists in the data that they already have, but may not be doing very much with, I think would be a very important sort of early step in sort of moving us forward.
Excellent. So any other questions from the group? And I'm having just a slight bit of challenge kind of seeing the question panel here. So maybe Rachel, if you can see any questions, you can go ahead and ask the group questions.
We have quite a few of them. This is Jacob, and I can try and knock some of them off because I think they happened during my monologue. So I'll read some and take Rebecca off the hook. Let's see. Are we RE gravity project and standards? Are we recreating the wheel from scratch in the US? Or are we borrowing from more experienced systems? Most of this work is happening through HL7, which is a global entity. So the work is aligned with work that other countries have been doing. But I would also offer that because we are here, there is a little bit of wheel reinvention, and obviously some of our goal is to minimize that. So that is happening a little bit.
So Jacob, how often does wheel reinvention happen with technology?
Well, I think it's every 2 weeks. Is that right, Tom?
Yeah, it's about what I was going to say. We don't tend to learn very good from our prior.
Well, which is it? I mean, we're mocking ourselves because we're, you know, in the IT domain. But my serious answer is that I think we've actually done a really good job. These standards have evolved. There are global standards, but we haven't yet solved some of the problems that I was trying to mention, which is the medicalization of the standards that are used in the IT systems. And so Gravity Project folks are really focused on that too, and they're very sensitive to this. One of the challenges has been, how do we get people from the domains of, you know, food, housing, transportation, et cetera, who are on the front lines, so people who work in community-based organizations, how do we get them involved in the standards process? Because typically they are not, and that's a challenge. And so some of the technology vendors that sell products to that, these industries are involved, but even they are a little bit less engaged than the medical technology vendors. And then, you know, people who show up are the ones who drive the agenda.
So one of the thoughts that has come out, and I know it's been an issue in our state, and that is reflective of how do we deal with, and Jacob, maybe you can kind of speak to this, how do you deal with the HIPAA kind of concerns that relate to sharing data in the way that that you're able to do? And I know you've really given it a lot of thought, so this is a good opportunity for us to kind of hear that.
Well, that's a trick question. So many of the organizations that are social care providers are community-based organizations and therefore not covered entities, and therefore HIPAA doesn't apply to them, which is both good and bad, right? Because if you are a HIPAA-covered entity, it's difficult for you to interact with a non-covered entity. You can't easily share data without the individual, sometimes referred to as patient, but notice I'm careful not to medicalize even the humans that we're working with. There are a couple ways to do this. One is through what some call consumer-directed exchange, and that is to empower the individual to retrieve their information. And in our region, we did that using the Health Information Exchange. And they retrieved their information for a millisecond, because then they took the information and they pressed a button, and the user experience is kind of like, you know, what you would have in, they say, a Starbucks, when they, you know, spin the iPad your way and you click the button to, you know, to do your signature. So the individual is assisted in looking up their information from the Health Information Exchange. They can do this at an uncovered entity. So there's a kiosk or a computer screen. You click the button, say, I want to share this information with the person sitting across from me. What that does is it sidesteps HIPAA, and that's not in a devious way. In fact, HIPAA was designed to do this, because I can take my medical information and I can put it on Twitter, right? And of course, you know, this is not fully understood by everybody involved, but I can do what I want with my data, including share it with the person who's helping me at the food pantry, homeless shelter, or if I really wanted to, my Uber driver. And there are valid reasons for all of these people to understand some of my medical conditions. And so that's one way that this could be done. There are 11 more ways, and I don't want to take up too much time and go through all of them. But to your point, this is non-trivial and you need to think very carefully about how you do it and do it well. I have seen community-based organizations sign business associate agreements with covered entities, and the covered entity checks the box, and the CBO has no idea what they just signed, and that is a problem. Because you can't just sign a BAA and get data to flow.
So that's very true. And I also kind of want to comment that there was at least one comment made that it's all great if we gather this data essentially, but what we need is the resources on the other side to actually respond and collaborate with. If you build it, do they come, Jacob? In other words, if we build the ability to collect this data, are we going to also then learn to build and expand the ability for others to deal with it and help our patients? And it's maybe a question no one's going to answer, but it's a question I'd say for the group, because there isn't yet enough on the other side. And I think to Keisha's point, we're spending too much on the healthcare side and not on the other side. So maybe one of the things we'll do is we'll learn what we have to build. So I'm cognizant of the time. There may be a few other questions. We will gather them and share them back with everybody. But I really want to thank our panelists for a very entertaining and interesting and engaging conversation. And just to all let you know that there are continuing medical and pharmacy education credits. There's some information about how to claim those up on the slides now. We will also send out for everyone that attended this information in an email in the next day or so. And I want to go ahead and thank our panelists and say good evening, everybody.
Thank you all very much.